So the world bid 2022 goodbye with probably a big good riddance as global markets closed out the year with their worst losses since the 2008 financial crisis. Let's take a look at the numbers here. The MSCI World Equity closing out with a roughly 20% fall for the year. Could there be relief in sight? Let's take a look at the race. The NASDAQ is down 33% last year. The Hang Seng also down 15.5%. The PSE index still off by 7.8%. Japan's TOPIX down 5.1%. Malaysia's market down 5.6%. Interesting to note how three markets in Asia are actually among the biggest gainers in the world last year, despite a stronger dollar. The three are India, Singapore, and Indonesia, almost as good as top-notcher Brazil's 5.2% gain. Will markets raise out of the gates tomorrow? Let's get you set up. CUL Financial's April Li Tan joins us this morning. Hi, April. Happy New Year.
Hi, Mimi. Happy New Year.
All right. So there's a lot of uncertainty over fundamentals, what economies will do, what the central banks will do, what earnings are going to do this year. But overall for 2023, how easy or quickly do you think is it going to be to leave bear market? Are you expecting a big kick this January or maybe a continued drag?
Well, that's an interesting and very tough question, actually, because there are some good points, actually, for the Philippines. The problem is there are also a lot of challenges. That's why it's quite a difficult question to answer. So on the positive side, of course, we know the resilience of the Philippine economy so far and the strong corporate earnings growth that have surprised analysts, including myself. And of course, the very cheap valuations of stocks and inflation now looking like, it hasn't peaked in the Philippines, but eventually it will. But we're on the tail end of that. So those are the things going for us. But of course, on the negative side, we still are looking at a potential global economic recession led by the developed economies, and that's not good. I mean, if the U.S. market does not do well this year, then unfortunately, that would have some contagion here in the Philippines as well.
Mm-hmm. All right. So what's your call for 2023, given all the plus and the minus factors that you talked about? What is your call for the PSE index? And I'm curious, what are you betting on this year?
Yeah, so, okay, notwithstanding all the threats, we're still telling our clients to be invested in the market. And for example, fundamentally, our fair value estimate for the PSEI is at the 8,000 level. In terms of PE multiples, we're at around 2 standard deviations below the mean. So it just means that, you know, stocks are so cheap. There are a lot of threats. It's scary, but you can't afford not to be invested. But, you know, that said, if you were to pick stocks to, I guess, you know, focus on or be heavyweight in, let's focus on more resilient sectors, such as the consumer sector, which will also benefit from falling commodity prices. The power sector, and also the banks, because we feel that the banks will benefit from the high interest rate environment, and it has shown relative resilience to weakness in the economy, as the banks have done a very good job of making sure that they've lent to the right borrowers.
Mm-hmm. All right, and I'm very curious, April. And this is where your outlook for interest rates come in. What is your asset allocation going to look like this year? I mean, how much in cash, how much in equities, and how much in fixed income? What is the advice?
Well, when we had our briefing, multi-asset briefing, we were recommending investors their investment portfolio at least, no, to, you know, probably allocate equally to, say, cash, to bonds, and to stocks, no? It's sort of like a barbell strategy. And, you know, the cash is not so much because we're scared, but it's more of, you know, taking advantage of opportunities, because we're seeing a lot of volatilities in the market, and you want to have a little bit of cash so that in case prices go down sharply because of some concern, then you can pick up some more at a very cheap price.
All right. Let's go over some interesting corporate stories now. You mentioned power earlier as a segment to watch. Here's one story. The Energy Department saying that the spot market, WESM, is going to begin commercial operations in Mindanao this January 26. Do you think that the, you know, everybody's saying it's the power play this year, we're all looking at a power supply shortage. What are some of the interesting names that you'd recommend investors to take a look at seriously when you look at the power space?
Well, of course, our favorite would be Avoitest Power, because, well, valuations are much more reasonable, and also they have some excess capacity that they can sell to the wholesale electricity spot market if there is a shortage. Mm-hmm. And if there is a shortage, we expect the price in the wholesale electricity spot market to go up. So that's a name that we're looking at. Another one would be Meralco. Well, of course, being a distribution utility, their earnings would be a little bit more resilient against any volatility that happens. And of course, they give attractive dividend yields to investors. So those are two examples of stocks that we like.
All right, just a bit more detail on this WESM and Mindanao. As of November last year, there were 69 out of the 100 expected participants in Mindanao that have completed their registration in the WESM. We know that this WESM in Mindanao has been delayed many times. One of the reasons was because the Mindanao-Visayas interconnection project has yet to be completed. Well, they're saying, the DOE is saying that the 52 billion interconnection project is expected to be finished by March of this year. Speaking of power, San Miguel Global Power, its unit, has agreed to supply power to debt-ridden Albay Electric Cooperative, or ALECO, for 12 months. How about this? The BSP, their data showed that for November, hot money inflow actually hit $489 million. Net inflows for January to November, the first 11 months of last year, hitting $794 million. Hot money, this is money that enters and leaves very quickly, including stocks. What are you seeing when it comes to flows for 2023?
Yeah, so that's another reason that I forgot to talk about why I'm more optimistic about the Philippines and what I'm kind of looking forward to. Because, I mean, one of the reasons why foreign investors have stayed away in the Philippines, even though they're heavily, very heavily underweighted. I mean, it's so unbelievable how underweight they are. But one of the reasons why they've stayed away is because of the strong dollar, the weak peso. But now there are signs that the dollar is no longer strengthening or it has peaked, which is one of the reasons why we saw an inflow into the Philippines. Because remember, the peso, after threatening to hit senior citizen level, right? All of a sudden, it strengthened. And it's not only the Philippines. It's, if you listen to a lot of economists and strategists talking globally, they are talking about the greater resilience of emerging markets and, of course, the peaking of the U.S. dollars and funds flowing to emerging markets, which are also trading at much cheaper valuations. And we are one of the beneficiaries of this trend.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of for the stock market, as of December 29, we were looking at the numbers. Year-to-date net foreign selling was at 68.1 billion. So by tomorrow, I'm sure we're going to get more final numbers. Another one, this one is for the transport sector. The DOTR is expecting to award all remaining contract packages for Metro Manila Subway Station within the year. We're talking about 7 to 8 more contract packages. The subway is designed to have 17 stations that will connect Valenzuela City to Pasay City. It's expected to service over 519,000 passengers on a daily basis once completed. It's going to cut travel time from Quezon City and Naia, between Quezon City and Naia and Pasay City, to just 35 minutes from 1 hour and 10 minutes at present. Just very quickly, when you think about the Metro Manila Subway Station, some of the companies that come to mind would be Megawide, of course, and Tony Chu. Are there any other names that might benefit from this massive infrastructure project?
If I'm not mistaken, I think DMCI is also bidding. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they do have the financial capacity to do it. Mm-hmm. I mean, they've had a windfall from the strong prices of coal, right? Mm-hmm. So I think they're in a good position to benefit from this as well.
Are you still betting on the infrastructure names? I remember at the start of the Duterte administration, they promised the golden age of infrastructure. Did they actually deliver? And what are the prospects for the next 6 years?
Yeah, I think, this administration is still focused on developing infrastructure. Mm-hmm. I guess the reality is that it just takes time. So, yeah, I think when you invest in the infra names, just make sure you have a long investment time horizon.
And a lot of patience. All right, yes. April, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Do you like this stock? Why?
Yeah, so I think my blind item is very easy to guess because it's one of the few stocks that had a big scandal recently.
Okay.
And because of that, it was sold off sharply. But, you know, this company, they had an analyst briefing where they talked about the problem. And it seemed like, you know, what people were thinking was not as bad as it seemed. And aside from that, of course, the share price seemed to reflect a lot more negativity than, you know, what really transpired. Mm-hmm. So, you know, based on our computations right now, we think that there's still an upside of, say, around 30%, even though the stock is off its lows. I think there's still opportunities for it. Aside from that, we are seeing the insiders buying the stock. And of course, this company has committed that they will continue to pay cash dividends.
All right. I think with so many clues, you've already given away the name, but we'll see. Our viewers, we're encouraging them to tweet us to their guesses. We'll find out at the end of the show. Thank you so much, April, for joining us today. Happy New Year. See you again soon.